The third theory that we use for ductile materials is ductile Coulomb-Mohr's theory. Unlike the case of maximum shear stress theory and distortion energy theory, this is used exclusively for uneven materials. So the MSS and D theories cannot be used for material which are uneven. That means where the tensile behavior and compressive behavior are different. So therefore, because it's a yield ductile material, we have two different variables, sigma yield point in tension and sigma yield point in compression. So in normally, if these two values are same, then the material is called even material. So if there is even material, you can go for either MSS or DE. Instead, if they are not same, then we can go for ductile Coulomb-Mohr's theory. Before we get into this theory, we'll introduce a concept called failure envelope. So the concept is failure envelope. Failure envelope is closely linked to concept of Mohr circle. So here, to get the failure envelope, we have to first draw the Mohr circle respect to uniaxial tensile test under tension. Okay. So if you are doing a UTM test or simple tensile test under tension, the stress at the failure is represented by this curve. So the first circle represents Mohr circle at the time of failure in tension. Okay. Similarly, the bigger circle represents the Mohr circle for the material at the point of failure in compression. So as you can see from this diagram, the difference in radius of these two circles is basically because the yield point in compression is larger compared to yield point in tension. And the third circle represents the shear stress Mohr circle. That is the Mohr circle corresponding to the failure point in the shear test. So this one is tensile test, this is compression test, and third one is shear stress. So once you get all the Mohr circles, approximately using a pencil, you can draw a curve like this, okay, here and as well as here, which touches the boundaries of this circle. So this envelope, this boundaries, the lines that you have drawn, which is tangent to all these curves, is known as failure envelope. It's called failure envelope. The idea behind failure envelope is, if for example, you have done for a material, you have generated the failure envelope like this. Okay, this is your failure envelope for that particular material. Now we want to know whether a point here is failed or not. So for that, what you have to do is you have to draw the Mohr circle. So Mohr circle can be drawn something like this. Imagine there is a Mohr circle for a particular state of stress, and this Mohr circle lies within the failure envelope, the component is safe. So suppose if you keep on increasing the stress, the size of the Mohr circle also increases like this. So in second case also, it is still safe. So if you further increase the stress, then the Mohr circle will be bigger one, and it crosses the failure envelope, and we say the component has failed. So it was one of the earliest theories proposed. Only difference is the line that we drew is basically an approximate line. So there is no mathematical foundation for this. So that is actually known as Mohr's theory, whose definition can be given like this. Failure is predicted to occur in the multi-state of stress when the Mohr circle associated with the state of stress at a given critical point becomes tangent or exceeds the boundary of the failure envelope. So once you know the boundaries, if you have to just redraw the actual Mohr circle for a given point of interest, and then if it lies within the failure envelope, the component is safe, otherwise it has failed. Based on Mohr circle, we'll propose what is known as Coulomb-Mohr's theory. So Coulomb-Mohr theory is basically a modification of the Mohr circle, except that we have some mathematically well-defined straight line here. Okay, so here we make certain assumptions in the, so what we studied earlier was Mohr's theory. Here we study what is known as ductile Coulomb-Mohr theory. So this is Coulomb Moore theory used for ductile material. So we call it as ductile Coulomb Moore theory. And what are the assumptions in this theory? The assumptions are, the first one is the Moore circle for shear failure is neglected. Okay, there we had done three tests. If you remember, one first circle represented the test respect to tensile loading, and the second one represent the stress corresponding to compression, and the third one represented the stress Moore circle corresponding to the shear test. So what we do is, here we neglect the shear test, we'll only use the tensile Moore circle and compressive Moore circle. So that is the meaning of this. So Moore circle for the shear failure is neglected in the construction of failure envelope. So earlier we used three circles and we drew a line which is tangent to all three circles. Now what we do is, we'll use only two circles, one corresponding to tensile load and another corresponding to compressive load, and then we'll draw a failure envelope like this. And another important assumption we make here is, the principal stresses at a given point are always arranged in this fashion. So there is some mathematical equations to be derived for this Moore Coulomb theory. So let's try to proceed with this. We have three circles drawn in this case. Okay, the first circle here, whose center is at C1, represent the tensile test, that is Moore circle corresponding to the material failure in tensile test. Similarly, this curve, that is the second curve, this dotted curve, represent the Moore circle corresponding to compressive test. So as you can see, the material properties are more stronger in compression side than in the tensile side. Now coming to the third curve, this solid curve represent the actual loading condition at a point of interest. Okay. So this varies depending on the load. So the maximum value this Moore circle can have is between these two. So this line and this line represent what we have defined as failure envelope. So these failure envelopes are the straight lines drawn between the Moore circle with respect to tensile test and Moore circle with respect to compression test. So a tangent line is drawn, this represents the failure envelope. So is the case at the bottom side. So to declare it once again, C1 is for tensile test and C3 is for compression test. In between, the C2 is for the actual loading Moore circle. So let's try to redraw this portion. So we'll try to draw a line here. We'll do like this, so that these three lines, this line, and this line are all equal. And this triangle is redrawn. This triangle that we're talking about will be redrawn. This is a construct for the derivation. As again, this C1 represent the center of the Moore circle for the tensile test, and C3 represent the Moore circle for the compression test, and C2 is the Moore circle for your actual loading case, which is to be tested whether it has failed or not. Okay. And this line is your failure line, only we are taking the top portion. Okay. Now let us consider the triangles B1, D2, B2. That is B1, D2, B2, this circle. So the inside circle is the first, the triangle. Similarly, we have B1, D3, B3. So B1, D3, B3. So the outer triangle is this one. These are similar triangles because we have got a common angle here. Therefore, we can write the expression now, B3D3. Okay, so it is B3D3 divided by D3B1. d3 b1. Okay, this divided by this must be equal to this line divided by this line. Therefore, this is d2 b2 divided by d2 b1. That's what b2 d2 divided by d2 b1. So this is the expression we get from the similar triangle property. Now we have already explained that these three lines are of equal length. So we have drawn this horizontal line such that all the three are equal. Therefore, C3 D3 is same as C2 D2 and is same as C1 B1. Okay, that's what we have written here. Now let's come back to the numerator of the LHS. So now we can rewrite this B3 D3 in terms of, okay, so let me write, this is B3 D3, this portion can be written as total length minus this length. So we can write this as C3 B3 minus this length C3 D3. So this C3 D3 is same as C1 B1. Okay, C1 B1 and D3 B1, that is D3 B1, this entire length, this horizontal length is same as C1 C3. I'm sorry. Okay, so that's what the new denominator is replaced by C1 B3. So coming to the RHS, we have B2 D2. Where is B2 D2? This one, the actual curve D2 D2, this portion is nothing but C2 B2 minus C2 D2. Okay, and as usual, the C2 D2 is replaced by C1 B1. So therefore you get C2 B2 minus C1 B1. So coming back to this denominator, D2 B1. So D2 B1, okay, this horizontal line is same as another parallel line, that is C2 C1. So therefore we are written as C1 C2. So this is first level of simplification. Now let us try to find out the values corresponding to these terms. If you observe this curve C3 B3 in the diagram, what is C3 B3? C3 B3 represents the radius of the compression Mohr circle. So we know that radius of the compression Mohr circle is nothing but sigma yield point in compression. For that we have written the notation, we have used simplified notation as SC here. Okay, similarly C1 B1 represents the radius of the tensile circle. Okay, so which is nothing but sigma yield point in tension, which we have simplified here as ST. So because its radius, we will get the value divided by. Okay, that is C3 B3 and C1 B1. Now look at the C2 B2. C2 B2 is the radius of this actual Mohr circle, that is Mohr circle of the point of interest. Similarly, we can write that as C2 B2 as sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2. This will get it from the definition of Mohr circle. Okay, this Mohr circle, if you remember, Mohr circle is drawn something like this, in which this point represents sigma 1 and this point represents sigma 3. Therefore, the radius will be, this value will be sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2. So that's what you have written. C2 B2 is sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2. Now the interesting part is C1 C3. So this C1 C3, okay, this entire stretch. So from here to here, from 0 to this portion, your is sigma yield point in tension by 2, and from here to here it is sigma yield point in compression by 2. So therefore in our simplified notation we have written as this SC by 2 plus ST by 2, and this C1 C2 here, C1 represents the center of the tensile Mohr circle. Therefore, that value from 0 to C1, so this value will be the sigma yield point in tension by 2, or in our simplified notation, ST by 2. So therefore, the coordinates are ST by 2, 0. Okay. Now coming back to this C2 is nothing but the center of the Mohr circle for the actual loading case. So when you study the Mohr circle, we know when you draw a Mohr circle something like this, okay. So the maximum stress is notated by sigma 1 and the minimum is notated by sigma 3. The center point will be average of this, therefore it will be sigma 1 plus sigma 3 by 2. This is the average value. That's why we written sigma 1 plus sigma 3 by 2. So if you want a distance from C1 to C2, this side it is, from right side it is ST by 2, and left side it is sigma 1, because these are coordinate values. So the delta x is given by C1 minus C2, the distance is equal to ST by 2, this is a positive value, minus of sigma 1 plus sigma 3 by 2, so it's on left hand side. So C1 minus C2 is given by ST by 2 minus sigma 1 plus sigma 3 by 2. Okay. Now we will substitute the values here. Okay. This has to be changed. This should be sigma 3. Okay. So when you substitute, you first cross, remove the 2, take 2 common all the terms, remove it, and then this will become sigma 1 minus sigma 3 minus ST, numerator ST minus sigma 1 minus sigma 3. So it's sigma 1 minus sigma 3. SC minus ST, so 2 is gone, so SC minus ST, denominator ST plus SC, so ST plus SC. So now you can cross multiply this. When you cross multiply this, so we have got sigma 1 ST. So if you take this term just into this, sigma 1 ST, sigma 1 ST, and minus sigma 3 ST, okay, and minus ST into ST, so minus ST square. Similarly, you can multiply with SC. Okay, so there will be sigma 1 SC, this term, and then minus sigma 3 SC, minus sigma 3 SC, and ST into SC, so minus ST into SA. So this becomes the this cross multiplication. This is your LHS. So RHS is multiplication of this into this. Okay, so ST SC, okay, ST SC, and then sigma 1 into SC, minus sigma 1 into SC, and minus sigma 3 into SC, so minus sigma 3 into SC. Similarly, we can multiply with the second term, ST minus ST, therefore ST square, minus sigma 1 ST, minus minus plus, so sigma 1 ST, get it, and minus sigma 3 ST, minus minus plus, so sigma 3 ST. So this is your RHS. So certain terms gets cancelled, so plus sigma 1 ST and plus sigma 1 ST gets cancelled. Similarly, sigma 3 SC and sigma 3 SC gets cancelled. So whereas the terms, or all the terms are transferred to accordingly, so you'll get expression like this. On further simplification, so you'll get something like this. So sigma 1 SC minus sigma 3 ST is equal to SC ST. Now we'll divide entire equation by ST SC as shown in this figures. So when you divide this, this divided by, so we'll divide this by ST SC, this divided by ST SC, and this also will divide by ST SC. So the right hand side becomes 1, and this SC SC gets cancelled. You have got sigma 1 by ST. So this is first term here. So here we get sigma 3 by SC, and this is 1. So this is the equation for ductile Coulomb Mohr theory. So if you want to convert it into design equation, so this is to be divided by n, that is n is nothing but factor of safety. So let's see certain notes on this point. So equation 11 and 12 represent Mohr Coulomb theory, of course, and sigma 1 here, you have taken sigma 1 to be the maximum value. Even while drawing the Mohr circle, you have taken sigma 1 as maximum and sigma 3 is the minimum. So whatever values you get, you have to arrange them in the order sigma 1 minus sigma 2, sorry, sigma 1 minus sigma 1 greater than sigma 2 greater than sigma 3. In this fashion, you have to arrange. And one other important thing is the original equation. Usually SC, that is compression stress, is even though it's compressive, it is given in some number. So sometimes they may give the strength as minus 300. So in that case, you should not take the negative sign, you should take only the magnitude. Therefore, you have put a absolute symbol here. So the magnitude of SC should be taken, because in our derivation, we have used SC as unsigned scalar, and hence we should not use the sign for SSG. Whereas for sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, whatever sign we get, we will use as it is, except for SC. Other things will retain their signs. And that we have already discussed, that is arranging them in particular order and accordingly. So for example, we have given an example where from the for 2D case we have got sigma A is minus 20 and sigma A is minus 30, and out of plane stress sigma C is anyway 0. So if you are arranging them in decreasing order, the first will get 0 and then minus 20 and minus 30. So according to our derivation, sigma 1 is the maximum value and sigma 3 is the minimum value. So these sigma 1s should be used in the equations for ductile column Mohr theory. So let's see how to plot this curve. So let's see the plotting aspects. Okay. So again, we'll get 6 cases here. So in first set of cases, we will have sigma A greater than sigma B. So the sigma A and sigma B are the principal stresses that we obtained from the equations that we have already shown earlier. So this is first set of case. Again, because there is a zero, there are three more possibilities. So when both sigma A and sigma B are tensile, that is positive in nature, so we'll get the case one. Or when both sigma A and sigma B are compression or negative, we'll get this case. So in second case, so sigma A is positive and sigma B is negative. So the one is tensile and that is compressive. So if you look at this, when you arrange in this fashion for the first case, okay, you always told sigma 1 should be the maximum and sigma 3 is minimum. So sigma 1 becomes sigma A, whereas sigma 3 becomes 0. So when you substitute in this equation, you will get a simplified version of this is same. So you don't have to worry about this. You can simply use the equation with the condition that the maximum is always sigma 1, minimum is always sigma 3. Whether 0 becomes a maximum or it becomes a minimum is not our botheration. So thus we will only see after the numerical value is obtained. In second case, where we have got one is tensile and one is compressive, sigma 1 it will become sigma B will become sigma 1 and sigma B will become sigma 3. Therefore, the equation can be used as it is. In third case, what is happening? Sigma has become maximum and sigma B is minimum. So in this equation, so we can say 0 by something is 0, entire thing is 0, you will get sigma B by, so this we have shown here. This becomes a simplified equation. So the effectively equation, this equation, this equation, this equations are equations of the straight line. As we discussed for earlier case, this can be drawn on a graph. Okay, so these curves, this, this, and this will represent these three cases. Similarly, we have second set of cases in which we have written, or we have the case in which sigma B becomes more than sigma A, and thus we will got three more curves. The expression is given here. You can pause the video and look into that. Okay. So we'll get another three curves like this. So when we plot all these curves, we'll get what is known as non-failure region. So if when you solve an equation for sigma A and sigma B, and this sigma A, sigma B lie within this region, then the component is safe. Otherwise, we can say it has failed. So that is about the ductile column Mohr theory.